on the Boss Man Show, special guest from For the Win, Chris Korman out of Baltimore, Maryland, so that I love a lot. Chris, man, you wrote a great column. Got some folks upset, man. I love it. I love throwing the pot, but you were so right, man. How are you doing, man? Post-article, man. I know those folks who are on the side of Kirk, Herbstreit, and Desmond Howard came for you and your mentions crazily, probably.
Yeah. I mean, I'm good. You know, a little snow here and playing with my kids, so can't complain too much about that. But yeah, the reaction to just like a very basic take, which I just did not expect. I mean, like I was telling you before, like people were telling me I'm what's wrong with America because I think that it's okay for college athletes to take care of themselves and do what's right for them. I mean, it's just it's a really weird little corner of the culture war.
Yes, and Chris, but I thought that a lot of Americans about freedom of choice, freedom of speech, and freedom of, but isn't there freedom of choice to not want to play the game that could harm your future earnings? Because I thought America's a capitalist country, you want to make much money as you can. Right. So a young man exercising his right to choose is now wrong. But oh, Chris, I know what it is, Chris, because you're not making a choice. They want you to make. That's why it's wrong.
Right.
That's why it's wrong, Chris.
The whole thing is just so ridiculous on every level. Like it's, I who cares about these bowl games too? Like I can't even name like 10 bowl games left. Like the Outback Bowl is now like historic because it's had the same sponsor for a long time, but it's still named after a chain that fries up onions, you know, like that.
Yes. The Mayo Bowl.
Right, there's a Mayo Bowl, right. I only know that because...
The Liberty Bowl in Tennessee, because I played football there when I was in college.
Right. You just, it's like these bowl games, they're nice, they're fine, they're whatever. Like players usually like going to them if they can, right? It's better than not going somewhere sunny in December and January. It's a chance to practice more football. It's a chance to be with your teammates. You get a little bit of swag. Like they're fine. But who are these fans who are pretending that they matter? And that like, why wouldn't you want a kid who's given you 3 or 4 years of his life, given that to your program, why wouldn't you want him to make the right decision for him and get prepared? You know, because like, you know this, these kids, part of what happens, right, is they have to train for the stuff leading up to the draft. And yes, that it's a totally different deal, right? Like a college football player is not doing anything during the season to get them ready to do all the drills they do at the combine they're worried about playing in pads. They're worried about doing all the things they need to do. They're watching film of opponents. Like it's a totally different deal. Why would you want them to have an extra month or two or whatever it is to get healthy? Cause they're not healthy after the season, right? They just played 12, 13. That's the other thing is Desmond Howard and Kirk Herbstreit didn't play as many games, right? Like they played
11 max. Right. In a bowl game, that's 12.
Right. Right. And like these kids now are playing that as the season, or if they're playing in conference title, you know, whatever.
14
like,
games, getting close right. Professional number of games right. At that point.
Right. So these kids, like they need to heal up, first of all. Then they need to start training for the other stuff. And then there's just a whole world now where, you know, like they're obviously they can connect with agents, right? If they say we're opting out of the bowl game, okay, now they get a jump on getting an agent. The agent gets a jump on getting them into the best training because there are different programs all over the country where you can go to prepare for all this. You want to get settled in to those spots and get ready to go. And like it's just, I mean, if you step back, why wouldn't you want that for the players who want to do it? Because not every kid opts out either. Like plenty of guys who are going to get drafted played in their bowl games. Just let the kids choose. You know, but it's just such an antiquated notion, man. It's
very much so. Like here in the Peach Bowl, Kenny Pickett not playing in the Peach Bowl.
Right.
He's still going to get drafted in the first round.
Right.
He rests his body. I'm watching him walk no more wear and tear in a game that it's good to say you want it, but I'd rather be healthy.
Nobody's ever going to mention that game again if he plays. And, you know, it's just not going to matter. And Micah Parsons skipped his whole last year. You know, obviously it was a little different because of COVID, but he made the right choice for him. And, like, is anyone questioning Micah Parsons' passion for football? Like, you know, you watch the guy play.
Last year, during the draft process they did. Right. But one now that he's with the Cowboys, they don't care no more. See, these GMs, these scouts and these regional scouts, these personnel people have this antiquated view, like you said, of love of football. The guy would not be out there in pads risking a injury every freaking play for 11, 12 times a year if he didn't love the game.
Right, right.
I mean, have back issues and knee issues from playing football.
Right.
And I haven't played the game since 2008.
Right. People who don't, who aren't close to the, like, if you're not, like, you know, I used, as a reporter, I used to go to practice, right, and, like, stand next to the collisions. Or if you're lucky enough, you know, and then my press pass would let me on the field at the end of games. And, like, to see how brutal football is up close. Like, yeah, there are people who, there are players who don't love, I'm sure this was your way, this when you were younger too. There are guys who don't love it. They're doing it still because they're good at it or whatever. Yes. But like, by and large, if you're doing this, if you're putting your body on the line, like, you have, your motivation shouldn't be questioned. You know, like, you are doing enough to get out there and do it. And it's just, you know, it's so lacking in nuance for them just to, mm-hmm. I mean, it's just old boy thinking, just, you know, like,
yes.
old man, old guard, just dropping, like, why is that on our TV? Why is that what we're getting when they could talk, ESPN could talk about any storyline they want. They could get any interview they want. They could do what they could dig into depth. They have every stat they ever need. They have every video. They could give us so much to make the game, to make it a richer experience to watch the game. And instead they're just throwing, you know, as I said, they're just throwing out lazy buzzwords. Cause they, you know, I don't know.
Because they sell with their demographic.
Right.
I mean, it's marketing, and it sucks. That's why I had to watch the game on mute, because I can't stand listening to Joe Tessitore and Greg McElroy make it all about, oh, Matt Corral's playing, and all of a sudden he got hurt. Then they right. at least he played.
Yeah.
Really? But are you going to pay him the money deals he may have missed because he got right. a high ankle sprain on a Superdome right. turf for a right. meaningless game?
Right. And now he's behind how many ever months in his training or whatever it's going to be, like, that's all that matters at this point, right? It matters so much for those guys and caring the right way. Like, what does that mean? Like, why is ESPN not talking about whether or not schools care about players, like, or coaches? Like, did Brian Kelly actually care about his Notre Dame players or not? Like, should we discuss that? Are the schools who don't give players long-term insurance, do they actually care about players or not? Do schools, scholarships are one-year renewable contracts. Like,
yes.
if schools cared, they'd probably give them 4 years. They'd probably say, hey, we're going to take care of you no matter what. Let's put it down on paper. You know, like, this idea that players have to care to show that they really mean it, or, you know, have to like sacrifice to show that they really care and they really mean it, whereas everybody else gets to make business decisions, it's ludicrous.
Is Kirk Herbstreit opting out any games to make him a bunch of money to run his mouth? No. Is Chris Fowler or Joe Tessitore or Greg McElroy, who should know better?
Right.
They should know better. As playing the game, should know better. But they don't, because it does not serve that narrative.
Right.
And that's why I can't watch. People say, why don't you watch sports talk? Because it's shameful. It's crappy. I'd rather be real. Like, I'm real with people. I don't sit around here making narratives. See, think about me, Chris. I don't go on this radio and say, let's talk about something I don't know about. If I'm not knowledgeable about it, I don't discuss it. Henceforth, hockey. I don't talk about hockey. I don't think about it. Okay? I can't give you any analysis about a hockey game. I can't talk soccer with you. Right. I can't talk about baseball, tennis, basketball, because I play those sports, football. I played them, intimately played them. I can discuss right. that. So I feel like these guys on the TV just want to push narratives and give hot takes and get the buzz. ESPN loves it because guess what? The clicks, the dimensions. It business algorithms, and they get the sponsor. Well, look, Kirk said this. Look at us now. So it sells. Being negative and being against the players sells. Because also, Chris, as you know this, it's programming. They need these players to play to promote the games right. on TV. So it's all about money. These young men, I was one of them, does not benefit from all the money these conferences, these TV partners make. I just get a per diem and some books. In a room, and that's all you get. If you go to a booster, you're ineligible.
Right. Yeah. I mean, it's Herbstreit and Desmond Howard could talk to whoever they want. You know, they could you know, they are talking in the, you know, they played football. Like, I get a lot of people brought that response to me in Twitter, like, oh, how would you know? They know because they played. But like, why don't they talk to the kids now? Why aren't they interviewing these players? Why aren't they talking to the other, to teammates? There's their ability to get information and to dig into this story and really cover it is unparalleled, right? They are in better position than anyone else to get that information. And they just opted not to. They just opted to, I mean, it sounded like I was at the corner bar listening to old guys talk about anything, just anything in society. That's just not good enough. That's not what ESPN, and it's not good for the game. Here's the weird thing for me, right? If ESPN was smart about it, you're right. Like, they want players to keep playing because they want fans to watch. They want fans to watch Jahan Dotson one more time. They want Penn State fans to say, like, oh, it's Dotson's last game. I got to tune in. But that ship has sailed, right? It's not going to happen. So be smart about it and use the bowl games, market the bowl games as a chance to see next year's team, as a chance to see the future, as a chance to see young guys, recruits that you read about 2 years ago who've been waiting their turn, and now all of a sudden they get their turn under the bright lights in late December, early January. Like, the sport is just different now. And coaches for years have used bowl season this way. Like, you know, like, it's what it is extra practice time.
Yes.
That's the beautiful thing about bowl games for coaches, right? Like, all, because if you got a losing record, you got to stop practicing November 29th or whatever. And then you are just cold until spring break. That's terrible for a football coach. You're losing all that development time. That's an awful thing to happen. But all of a sudden you get to go to the, you know, Meineke Tire Bowl, whatever, you know, the bowls that I can't even name.
The Pinstripe Bowl, Yankee Stadium.
Yeah, you get to go to a bowl game and all of a sudden you get 15 more practices. And that's, so now you're sorting out what's going to happen in spring practice. Like, what problems do I need to solve in spring practice? You're just getting a jump start in the next season. Like, every college football fan should want that. Like, I have argued in the past that you should want your seniors, your draft eligible players, you should want them to opt out, because it's going to open up room for the next generation to be better, right? Like, if a kid is going to play his first game next fall, and he's going to get jitters in that game, and he's going to need to start acclimating to what it's like to actually play, why not get him started now? Why not let him play one of these quote unquote big bowl games? And you're just that further along. I mean, it's just like, this should not be as big a deal as it is. It's just such a bizarre thing that we're getting stuck on.
Yes. It's just this whole, like you say, it's this old guard who should know better, but does not know better because they just who they are. Like for me, I know from playing football from 1991 to 2008, the effect they had on my body.
Right.
And I was from 4 years old up until I was 21 years old, okay? And I feel the effects now still. Right. So you in football, you have a short window to maximize your talent and your body before it gives out on you. So if I'm a guy who I got through my season, I have a first round, second round grade, third round grade, and playing this game is not going to really change my draft status one way or another. I'm going to make the business decision and save my body. But the problem is, Chris, as you notice, with social media, guys can control their own narrative. They're empowering themselves now. And these guys like Herbstreit and Lee Corso and Fowler, these people who are antiquated in that they were thinking, it gets on their skin. Because when you push back on their narratives and their concepts, now you're the one that's wrong. Not them, but you're wrong. These guys, it's their lives. Let those guys live their lives, do what's best for them, and you shut up and just call the game.
Right. I had people say to me, like, well, if they opt out of the bowl game, then how do we know that they're not going to opt out when things get hard in the NFL? Do you know what happened in the night? I think it was 1983. I don't remember it because I was 2 years old. I was 1 year old when this happened, probably. John Elway didn't want to play for the Baltimore Colts. And so we said he wasn't, like, he opted out of playing for the team that drafted him and got moved. Like, this is not, the fact that players want power is not new. What's new is that college athletes through decades now have slowly, very slowly, much too slowly, gained a little bit of power and a little bit of leverage. You know, they're able to transfer now. They're able to transfer more freely. They're able to do things like this. They have the ability to opt out because in the past, you know, 20 years ago or whatever, if a player did that, then the coaches would have badmouthed them to the scouts, and then it would have, like, but the NFL got smart. The NFL just said, like, we don't care. Like, we're not going to worry about all that, like, red flag character concern type stuff that we see as baloney. You know, like, they're obviously digging in on some things. They do a tremendous amount of work to figure out who these kids actually are, but they just got over that. And they just said, we need talent. You know, we need guys who can play. And if they want to make the smart choice, they make the smart choice. Like, that's not going to be a worry to the NFL. But the power structure in college sports has slowly, slowly, slowly changed. And it's going to keep changing, right? Like, players are eventually going to get the ability to bargain with schools. Like, they are going to be considered employees. We're headed that direction, right? All the momentum is headed that way. They already, you know, they can now sign NIL deals, which really is outside this discussion. You know, those are outside, but it's empowering players. And that's why, you know, like we're talking about, the old guard is just, they just get worried. They just see anything along those lines is like, wait, the sport is changing in ways that makes us feel uncomfortable. Let's have some backlash. You know, let's remember how it used to be. Let's be nostalgic about, oh, when we went down to that bowl, we all played. But like, the situations are so different now. Mm-hmm. Everything around it is so different. And I mean, if Desmond Howard were coming up in this era and had known that he could skip a meaningless bowl game and get prepared and do all the things to focus on his pro career, he would have done it too. Like, he would have been in that group that was making, or he would have had to make that decision. Again, not all these guys make the same decision, but they all go through some calculus. It's just a natural thing. Like, and every other college student gets to do this too, right? Like, every college student, if they, you know, if they're an accountant, they can say, and they get an internship offer, and it's going to cause them to not be on campus their last semester. Like, they have to make the choice. Like, do I want to be with my friends for my last semester, or do I want to start my job early? You know, I wrote for my college newspaper and then I didn't because I started writing for other places. Like, this is what college is supposed to do, right? It's supposed to prepare you for what's next. And we let everyone else make their decisions, you know, just like we've let everyone else capitalize in their name, image, and likeness if they were able to forever. But for some reason, we pretended that college athletes were some special class just because they got scholarships, even though everyone else is eligible to get scholarships too. You know, it's just the breaking apart of this weird amateurism scam that has been around for so long.
A big scam. I remember we'll show up for July practice. You're here for football. Right. And we're no class. You're for football. Right. It was said out loud by the coaches. Right. You're here for football. Right. You're not here for the NFL. Like, you're majoring in football first and foremost. Right. Why you're here. Football. Right.
Because those coaches make more than any, you know, like, they make, especially now, right? Like, the offensive coordinator at most big time schools makes close to what the president makes, you know, like, this is the balance of power. Like, it's very clear. And their jobs depend not on whether a student does well, not with the APR, not the graduation rate, any of that.
Nope,
none of that, none of that matters. Right. Winning, that's it. That is all that matters. And honestly, for a lot of them, what matters most, it's like winning is like 60% and then recruiting is 40%. So you, as a student who are already there, don't even matter at all that much. You're not their that's not 100% what they're focused on, because they have to recruit. They're thinking about some 10th grader in Ohio that they need to recruit in 2 years. Like, the whole that is what their job is, right? So it's hard to even blame them, right? It's just the system is so broken. The system being tied to education, trying to make kids do a 50-hour job of playing college football and go to school is, you know, it's like, it works for some people, right? Like, some guys go and get a great education, but it's a really tough ask to demand that of so many different players, especially these guys, starters, offensive linemen taking dozens of hits to the head, you know, constantly battling in the trenches, defensive linemen. I mean, That's really tough. It's a really difficult job to do, and to ask kids to try to do both, and then to add, to have fans who like are sort of expecting this purity, you know, this like, oh, they should want to play for the logo on the jersey. Like, you know, that's just not, it's not realistic.
You know what, Chris, is what's funny that, you know, we go over to play at Vanderbilt, which is like 2 miles from Tennessee State. You get called out of your name by the fans of Vanderbilt. Like, we're literally neighbors. We're 2 miles away from Vanderbilt, literally 2 miles away from Weston Avenue, right? And we're getting called out of our names in the same city.
Right.
So, like, all you care about is winning the game, but you don't care about the people on the field. That's the part that's also not said, too.
Right.
Like, no. In the South, they cheer for a lot of us young black men. They cheer for us, but can none of our issues pass once the game ends? We don't care about you no more. Thank God you won the game for the whole time, but if right. you get put by the police, we don't care.
Right.
This is the South. It's crazy. So for me, Chris, I see that angle of it too. That it's like, hey, all you care about is me making you money. You don't care about me as a person. Right. I'm not human to you. I'm just entertainment to you.
Right.
Or I'm some a negative name that you want to call me because I'm beating your entertainment. You know right. what I'm saying? Because yeah. you think Nashville was better than that, but it's not.
No. I mean, state college is not better than that. I mean, you know, I went to Penn State, like the racism there, you know, I covered sports in Bloomington, Indiana, like, you know, Indiana's Indiana, but like Bloomington's a very progressive place. And I mean, it permeates the sort of, you know, I mean, it's been talked about by so many different writers. Taylor Branch wrote in The Atlantic years ago now about the plantation mentality of college sports. And, you know, mm-hmm. It's plain for anyone to see that, you know, I argued with people online who just like, they should play. I'm like, well, why should they? They just should. But what are you talking about? They just should play. Like, why can't they make a decision like anyone else?
Look, exactly.
They get to play college. But like, no, you know, like these guys had to work incredibly hard. You know this, you had to do it yourself. Like it's an incredible amount of work. It's an incredible amount of sacrifice. Yeah. They're blessed with amazing athleticism and size and skill and whatever, but like, they still have to capitalize on it. Right.
Yes.
You know, it is like, they deserve to get to have a say. They don't drop all rights when they sign a scholarship form or when they commit to some coach who's getting paid, by the way, $100 million over 10 years guaranteed. Mm-hmm. It's just this whole mentality of, and I think that there's just more people than I realize enjoy that part, you know, that is part of the allure for them, is that like, yeah, these guys, they have to, they're our guys for our college and we own them. And they have to listen to our coach. And it's just like, whoa, like, why aren't you guys supporting the player? Like, why don't you want what's best for the player in question that you're rooting for and that is going to college at the same campus where you went? And why don't you want him to be able to have a good experience too? Why is it more important for you to be able to shout at him, you know, during the game and then badmouth him after the game for whatever you've determined, you know, his character is based on? I don't know, shouting at a coach or something on the sidelines, you know, whatever.
What I'm saying is, in football and basketball, any kind of sport, you have spirited discussions.
Right.
Doesn't make you a bad guy.
No.
Because I tell my coach, F you in the heat of a battle, don't mean I already mean it, F you. In that moment, F you, but not like F you for real. Right. You know, but see, all these fans don't understand. It's all about this projection of their morality upon you. Like, no, it's not how we operate, you know?
Right.
You know, yeah. like
and coaches say that stuff all the time, right? Like, I mean, yes. and fans view that as like, oh, he's a tough coach. He's doing it, you know, he's driving, he's getting the most out of his players, but like, the players can demand more out of coaches too. Like, that's yes. fine as well. I mean, it's a cooperative, you know, like, it's a cooperative thing when you building a sports team, as every coach knows. Like, we just saw one of the better college coaches of all time fail spectacularly in the NFL, and everyone knew it was going to happen. Everyone knew that Urban Meyer was not going to make it in the NFL, yes. precisely because he cannot, he has always operated one way in college sports, which is that he has all the power.
He's
all
the leverage. He's right. A dictator.
And you that's get not, to the NFL.
That's grown men that. With families, right. Wives, and kids.
Right. And making more money than you. You know, like you're not even the richest guy in the building anymore. Like Trevor Lawrence is going to make way more money than you are. So you better learn to get Trevor Lawrence on your side and get him to want to work with you. And you better show Trevor Lawrence that you know what is best for him and every other guy on that roster, right? 53 plus this practice squad. Like you have to prove it. You have to show that you understand the game at a higher level or that you have hired other people to understand the game at a higher level and not a guy who got fired by Iowa for being racist as the strength coach. Like you can't do that and expect it to work. You actually have to earn the respect of your players.
Yes.
It's not just built in. And that's why, like, why not? Why are we still doing this with college sports? Why are we still allowing it to be this way where these dictators have so much power? Like, why not just make it a little bit more like what the rest of us expect out of our workplaces, right? Like exactly. Nobody wants that sort of situation.
Exactly. It's sad, Chris, because like you said, man, like that's why Matt Rule's having trouble in Carolina. He's running like a college coach. His way or the highway.
Right.
So he's failing in Carolina. Steve Spurrier failed with the Washington football team because that same mentality. But John Harbaugh in Baltimore, in your city, he understands men and people.
Right. Yeah. Charles McDonald and I were talking about this recently on our podcast that John Harbaugh, because John Harbaugh is like really from a college coaching family, right? His dad was a longtime coach, mostly as an assistant, but he had some head coach stints. His brother coaches Michigan, obviously now, like they are very steeped in that culture. I remember, I can't remember what year it was. It might've been the year they won the Super Bowl, but Harbaugh had come in and he was sort of rah-rah, like sort of that type of guy, like brotherhood, but you know, we're a brotherhood and we're fighting for each other and we're going to be tougher. And he had Ed Reed and Ray Lewis in the locker room then. And they just said like, no, this is not how you do it. You don't do this as a professional coach. And John Harbaugh, to his credit, adjusted and became the type of coach that he needed to become. And now he's easily one of the top five NFL coaches out there. You know, he's like this, you know, I know that everyone's a little bit down on the Ravens right now because they lost a bunch of games in a row, but that team should have never been anywhere close to as good as it was this year with all the injuries they had and everything they've gone through. He's a really good coach. And it was because he made that adjustment. He started treating his players like men, like people, you know, and like partners in the endeavor of winning football games and not pawns that he was adjusting and moving around and that he knew what was best for all of them. And he was the one with all the answers. You know, he listens to the analytic people more than any other NFL coach, pretty much. I mean, there's a couple other guys who were in that conversation, but he is allowing computer nerds to come in and like, okay, you know what, you have good information. I'm going to use it. And that's just a totally different mindset. Like that's a huge credit to Harbaugh that he was able to make that adjustment.
And Chris, guys like Bill O'Brien, Eric Mangini, Brian Flores in Miami, Mike Vrabel, that style works when you're winning.
Right.
When you start losing, guys tune you out real fast.
Right. So many of Belichick's Judge, right? Judge is like just, he's a mess because he's trying to act like he's Bill Belichick, but you're not Bill Belichick yet, bud. Like you gotta win some games. You gotta make some players better. You gotta take a team and make it better than the sum of its parts before you do that, which Bill Belichick does on the regular. Matt Patricia, like what was that guy doing in Detroit? And now it's so different to see Dan Campbell come in. Like Dan Campbell's like a traditional sort of like, I mean, he literally opened his press conference by being like, we're going to bite people's kneecaps off, right? Like he is a caricature of a football coach, but he hired a really great staff and he is working to get the acceptance of his players. You know, he has worked to try to have them on the same side, right? He's not like Matt Patricia was so standoffish and always acted like he had all the answers and that he was the one. Dan Campbell just hired a terrific staff. It seems to me that he lets them work, lets them solve problems. And he's sort of the guy who's managing the personalities in the locker room. And those guys, I mean, that team plays so hard. Like, and it shouldn't. Everybody knew that team was going to be terrible. You know, and honestly, the Texans are another case. Like, David Culley has done a really good, like, that team plays hard. They're totally outmanned, but something about what he's doing, and he worked with Harbaugh. He was a longtime college assistant, but worked with Harbaugh most recently. He's a guy who, like, clearly the players have bought into him, right? They are playing for him. And I'm guessing that if we were to dig into the locker room and talk to players, or if we could be in there, it's because he respects them and is making them a partner in the work that's being done.
And I'll say, even who got fired, Atlanta, Dan Quinn, he got fired because he couldn't recover from a Super Bowl loss. But nobody in the building, Atlanta Falcons, would have hated Dan Quinn. He was liked by everyone because he's real. He's positive, high energy. He treats you like a man. It's a brotherhood. It's a partnership. But the only thing about Dan Quinn was they couldn't close the deal because his defenses were predictable. You know, that's the thing about Dan Quinn. But Dan Quinn's reinventing himself with the Dallas Cowboys.
Right, and he's going to get head coaching interviews again. Like, he's going to be in those conversations. I think he's already in the conversation for the Jacksonville job, maybe. So you're right. It was just that he had one defense and he was just going to do it. And he's got to realize, and it does appear that he's becoming more flexible. It's
that Seattle cover three scheme that Ken Norton's getting killed with right now. Because everybody ran it because it was so good. The Jaguars under Gus Bradley, he runs it with Oakland now. The 49ers run it with D'Amico Ryans, and Robert Saleh runs with the Jets. Everybody got caught on that Seattle scheme. So Dan Quinn never changed it. It was just cover three every time.
Right. But not everybody had Earl Thomas and Cam Chancellor. That's correct. That's the problem. You know, you can't. So you gotta work with what you got. So, it does appear that he's adjusting now.
Yeah. So, you know, like I said, I love people like Dan Quinn, people like John Harbaugh, because they're even Mel Tucker. And the funny thing about this, Chris, is when Mel Tucker was in Colorado and in Georgia, I had him on my show. He's in Michigan State. And I can't find him because they won't let me talk to him, of course.
Yeah, that's that happens. You had Mike Woodson on your show recently, right?
Yes. Isn't
that
right? Yeah, from Atlanta Hawks days. Yes, Mike. See, the hat on. Yeah, from the Hawks days, Mike Woodson's very cool. But Chris, it took me having to tell the PR guy, Mike Woodson knows me personally. That Woody confirmed it, that he do. Yes, I know JR. You know, it took me having to pull that card. And, hey, I know Woody from Atlanta Hawk days.
that's tough, man. That's how it is. That's, again, getting back to Kirk Herbstreit and Desmond Howard. That's the frustrating thing, is they could talk to anybody. You know, they could if they really cared about this issue, if they really wanted to understand it. Not only could they talk to people about it and get the real story, but they could also, like, help fix it. You know, they could be the ones who come up with a better idea. How do we get players to be involved in the bowl game? Because, like, that's the other thing, is that these guys are just opting out of the part where they could get hurt, right? Like, they could still be around. They could still be.
And they were, and they are around.
Right. Like, they could still be around.
They're not playing in the game.
Right. And bowl, like, the other thing about bowl games, so for, like, you know, for schools like Penn State, they're generally always going to go, like, fans put aside the money to go, right? Like, the vacation, like, okay, we don't know where we're going to go on vacation in between, you know, from Christmas to New Year's, but we know we are going to. So we're going to put aside some money and we'll go there. And, like, all that other stuff is really the fun stuff. There's, like, the teams are doing, you know, non-COVID times, I think they're probably doing more, but the team, there's parties, there's things, you know, there's team, official team hotels, and there's events where they're playing video games against each other or whatever. Like, that stuff is at least as much a part of it as the game itself, right? A lot of these games are just, like, it's fun to see, like, Penn State play Arkansas. You know, they're not usually going to play Arkansas. Like, that's a neat part, right? You see teams play that generally don't play, or bigger name programs that you didn't expect to play, like, that, all that part's fun too. But, like, why not just be smart about it? Find other ways to get these guys involved. Find other ways to have them there and be remembered. Just deal with the fact that, like, this is the right thing. Like, that's ultimately, it's the right thing to do for these kids.
Yes.
You know, and I'm not criticizing, I would never criticize anyone who wants to play. If they want to play, have
more power to you.
Right,
but don't come down on people who choose not to play. Right. That's you and our issue with the whole. Don't make it like they're don't love football or they're bad people because they chose to make decisions for them or call them selfish.
They're entitled. Like what are we talking? Like they have the same entitlement that the rest of us have, which is to decide what we want to do with our lives, decide how we want to chase our dreams. I mean,
Chris, it's just sad, man. The state of our affairs in this country is that, hey, if you don't do it my way, you're wrong. Or if I don't agree with how you did it, now you're the problem. Like, really? Right. And I'm like, that's so it's just terrible. What kind of morals is that? Like, I thought this country was founded on freedom, right? Do what you want to, right? I thought it was found, but I know otherwise. But it's like, I'm like, for real? Right. And like you said, with access, like for me, Jerry Stackhouse, who I know personally from playing Atlanta Hawks, I had to drive to Nashville and tell them personally, I have his office numbers in my phone. I'm going to have him on my show because I always call it myself. Which one do you prefer? Do you prefer I just do it behind your back, or just or you do it the right way? Because see, these SIDs, I've been doing 11 years, Chris. And I call them out, and I tell them how they are, and I tell their coach. I'll give you an example. Rick Pitino's son in Minnesota, with New Mexico. Mm-hmm. He told me the request and I never got to him. I said, Coach, I know it didn't get to you. I know it's not you. It's the SID having a power trip.
Right. And and why? Like, why hide these people who are doing this thing that so many fans care about and who want to talk about it? Like, athletes want to talk about their decisions and the process. And, you know, they don't want to, like, sometimes you don't want to answer tough questions about, like, why did you call this or call that? But, like, people, I think you're a thoughtful guy. Like, you want to talk to them about how they got there and what their process is and what,
like, that's what the beat writers ask you about, why somebody didn't play. I'm asking you about real life background stories, not to any SID. Do your homework on me. Look who I talk to. Look who's on my show. Why would Mike Woodson come on my show if I wasn't legit? Why would, you know, Josh Pastner come on my show if I wasn't legit? Or Brad Brownell, or Will Wade LSU, if I wasn't legit. You know what I'm saying? You want to hide your coach from my show, but because what? I'm not ESPN, I'm not Fox, I'm not whoever big name you want to cower to. See, being an independent radio host like I am, brother, it's like I catch the hell because I don't go by all the rules. I don't ask dumb questions. Any coach that's been on my show enjoys it because I'm not asking the same boring questions that they get every day from the beat writers and ESPN people. And, oh, well, Coach, why isn't this guy playing? I'm not asking any questions. Those are between you and your player. I'm going to ask you about some other stuff because I'm in Atlanta, Georgia. A lot of rival recruits in football and basketball are in Georgia. And guess what? It can benefit your program. But a lot of SIDs don't see it that way because I'm not ESPN or Fox or NBC or whatever.
Yeah, and it's a frustrating thing with ESPN. Like, they have, you know, they made a big deal out of Kirk Herbstreit. Like, he covered like 5 games and then flew overnight and then did that show. Like, you're ESPN. You have other people, first of all. Like, they have Mike Golic Jr., who's brilliant and smart and understands what's going on with today's game. Like, you have other people. Just use the other people or hire more, you know, like just get people who are more in touch. At least have someone on that set who can say to Kirk Herbstreit and Desmond Howard, like, well, guys, here's the thing now with players, or let's take this into consideration, or what about this? Like, let's talk about this. Like, and I understand that, I guess it was maybe Reese Davis who was on at the time, like, kind of tried to do that, tried to steer it back. But it's just a shame. Like, why not have an actual robust debate? Why not have a real discussion of it rather than just let two guys tee off on current players?
And it's lazy broadcasting too. ESPN's very lazy because I've saw the behind the scenes how that works. They have these little meetings where I'm gonna say it is, you say it is. They know they each other gonna say off before the show starts. It's live, but very much same time scripted, same time too. Right. Since I found that part out years ago, I don't want no part of this. They're actors. Like Stephen A. Smith off the camera, it's different. It, when the countdown starts, the character comes on.
Right.
So like knowing that from intimate knowledge of going doing a tour and learning about it. I don't watch that stuff, Chris. I tell listeners, it's all an act. It's all a performance. Don't fall for the okie doke. Yeah. So, and they could be so much better, but they choose not to.
Right.
Because it doesn't pay with their sponsors.
Oh, it's frustrating, man.
You know, and their sponsors tend to be very conservative and want it a certain way.
Right.
So they appeal to that.
And status quo. I mean, they just want it to not change. You know, like, and so much, a lot of this discussion too is actually rooted in the transfer portal, right? For the people who are upset, it's an extension of like, oh, now players, they can transfer and they, whenever things get tough, they just leave. And you know, this whole like thing that they've
coaches do it all the time though,
right? Coaches
Brian Kelly
and anyone else in college. Anyone in college, you know, like if you got to a college and didn't like it, what do? You transfer. Yes. Nobody says like, oh man, you're a bad person. You gave up really quickly, didn't you? Like, no, they just say, oh, you didn't like it there, and you thought this place would be better. That's cool, great.
Same with a job, a 9-to-5. You got a job, it's not treating you. You might find a job, make give you more money. You go. Doesn't mean you're a bad person. So it's like this whole these false narratives, these conflations, these red herrings out here, man. It's sickening. And as a guy who played the game, I'm like, really? Now, I play at the FCS level. Let's not even talk about the resource gap between a Tennessee State and Tennessee in Knoxville. Let's not even go there. Because people don't know it. Vanderbilt's a private school. So that don't really count. Let's talk about Memphis compared to Tennessee State for funding and resources. We don't want to have that discussion.
Yeah. So, totally different. I mean, just totally HBCU different world.
School having, you know, hand me down shoulder pads from the Titans.
Right.
We don't even want to go there.
Did you guys really have pads from the Titans?
Yes.
Wow. Wow. That's.
I'll tell you no joke, my brother.
That's
per
wild.
Diem $10.
$10.
Yes.
Oh man,
having to find a female friend or whoever lets you use their meal plan to get you some food extra after hours,
right? So, right,
so
and like so, that stuff is barely getting fixed now, you know, like there's like, you know, there's the schools are allowed to pay a little bit, you know, the cost of living adjustment or whatever, like whatever they call it, like we're barely getting to the point where we can do that. You know, like it's just so ridiculous. Like,
yes.
It's just, we're barely making progress. And like, you know, stuff is winding through the courts that's going to change how college sports work. But like, and people are just freaking out about it.
It's just, if it'll change, man. Like, guy Chris, I can tell you so many horror stories about my 4 years of having to deal with crap like what I just told you. You know what I'm saying? But these guys are having on their high horse.
Right.
Like, if I made a choice to leave what I just described to you, that don't make me a bad person. I want something better.
Right.
And I will tell you no joke. If Georgia State had a football team, I would have stayed in Atlanta. But they didn't have football in 08 when Bill Curry came.
Right, right. Yeah, he relaunched the program.
So that was my senior year. Why am I going to do that? I'm going to sing.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So that does not make you a bad person that you decide to leave something that you feel is better for you.
Right.
You know, it's like, for real, like, you know, like Tennessee State made more money playing the HBCU classes than they did playing an OVC. Personally, I'll tell you, we cut about the 4 schools in the HBCU games, the Power 5 game we played for money. We're talking about OVC teams. We're talking about Austin Peay, Tennessee Tech, or UT Martin. We didn't care about them. We cared about the first game of the season. We played in the 4 HBCU Classics and the 1 Power 5 school for money. We didn't care about none of that stuff.
Right.
You know, because that was the fun to us. Like, those are bowl games. You know?
Right. Right.
You know, but these guys on your high horse, like, come on. Like, the kids over at Vanderbilt, all the money they get, just and they suck every year. You know?
Yeah, I mean, there's just no truth to it. You know, there's just no. It's the frustrating thing. It's like there's nothing to it that these kids care less. You know, in so many ways they. I don't even know how you could measure how somebody cares about something, you know, like through the years, but like, again, to play football now, like they're spending all summer at camps too. Like, yes. Like when Desmond Heron, Howard, and Kirk Herbstreit came up, like they probably just like, even back then they may have been good enough to go to a couple things here and there, but like the average kid who wants to become a college football recruit now is doing 7-on-7, yes, and camp after camp after camp. They're giving up so much stuff over the summer, right? Like they, yes, it's just the whole business around college sports and around even just getting into college sports, the business around high school sports, the business around private training, private lessons, all of that is so much bigger than when those guys were involved. Like for those guys, it was like, ball out for your high school team, do a good job. Your high school coach will talk to a college coach and get you a scholarship and then do a good job there. And maybe you'll get to the pros. And like, it was just very, very linear, right? It was mm-hmm. just sort of simple for them. It was all laid out, but now it's just a totally different deal, right? There's just so much more to it. And like, the other thing we're talking about with like the whole idea, like, oh, if you transfer, you're not resilient. You're too young to make that decision. You're not learning to fight through adversity because the first thing that comes along, you're giving up. Well, like, why don't we let these players have agents? Because an agent is someone who works for the player and has the player's best interest in mind. Every pro player and the vast majority, a couple guys represent themselves, but they have an agent and they work through the agent for everything. Because they want that guy to be a second voice helping them guide them. And they're supposed, because they've been through it before, they understand the ins and outs. Like, why don't we let college players do that? Why have we always just had these ridiculous rules that like, oh, that might lead to, I don't even know what it would, like, why, what were we so afraid of? Like, oh, cheating or, well, guess what? There's already cheating in college.
Oh,
sports.
Yes, it is.
Already.
Oh, yes. I can tell you stories about that. I won't say them all over the air, but I know how to get around that stuff too. It's crazy, man. And see, I would love to be on that show to give them the people the truth about what happened. See, they want to paint this whole pie in the sky. That's the Power Five level. The Group of Five level now is getting to that point. But back when I played, like, I thank my father. My father was my judge machine. Mm-hmm. I was going to run around to my father in the park,
right,
to get good.
Yeah.
Then I had to go. I played basketball and baseball, trying to find a way out of the hood. You know, if I was that good at football, could run fast, me and you would be talking today, Chris. It took my dad working with me every day after school to try to find me a sport that get me out of our situation in west side of Atlanta.
Yeah.
So when I hear those guys at Herbstreit and Howard, it offends me because
right.
I, without football, I wouldn't be where I am today.
Right.
But if I made a decision to leave Tennessee State and go to Georgia State or wherever I wanted to go.
All of that would have been wiped away. You didn't actually love the game.
Yeah, that's why it struck me in such a wrong, because I know football got me to where I am today talking to you, Chris. If I could talk to Mike Woodson or talk to Josh Pastner and call them friends of mine, right? Because my dad took me out in the yard and took me to the park to catch footballs to find something to get me out of that situation. But I don't love the game because I decided to leave somewhere. That's right. Why it's hit me the wrong way, Chris.
Right, right. All the work that they put in, like, you know, they deserve the chance to decide what they want to do. And they don't need to be questioned. Like, it's not some moral failing to decide that it's better off for them to spend their time a certain way. You know, it's...
Yeah. You know what, Chris? Not the massive lesson before we wrap up here, Chris. I resent and reject being told how to live my life, what to do. with my personal decision with my life and have some other person who does not know my background, my rooting, to tell me, JR, you don't love this because of you did this. How do you know that? You're not in my head. you don't know why I made the decision I made or why I did what I did. Who are you to sit on your high horse, your pencil, to tell me or any other person was a decision that was a wrong decision? Maybe in that current environment, it was what's best for them. Except that, because see, Chris, I tell people who they are. I don't try to change anybody. You are who you are. I'll have an engaged conversation with you about a topic, but in the end, you are who you are. I don't care. I don't care who person is. But I feel like these guys at ESPN want to project their own way of knowing and their own way of being on everybody else. If you don't see it that way, you're wrong. You need to be changed. You need to do better. No, who are you to decide what's better and what's not?
Right. And that's who they appealed to. That's who I heard from. It's just people who, I don't know, they just want to be angry about it. They just want to be angry. They just want to feel like things are spinning out of control and that, it's just not like it used to be. Like, no, it's actually better. Like, watch college football. College football's amazing now. It's the sport itself is just absurdly amazing. Like, the schemes, what they're doing, the talent of the players, the across the board. It's as good a sport as it's ever been. Just stop. Like, if you really love sports, just sit and watch the game and you'll still see a beautiful athletic contest between amazing athletes. Like, none of that has changed. You just want to sit back and get angry about the players getting a few more rights. Like, it's weird, man. These people, like, I also can't fathom, like, reading something I don't like and, like, them, like, tracking me down, like, spending more time to be, like, you know, send some of the stuff they sent to me, which I might be able to say on your show, but I definitely could not say on ESPN or anything else. You know, like, some of the stuff I was told about myself because I had this opinion is just, why? Like, what are we getting so angry about? But it's just, there's something rooted there that they would rather just feel upset about it without ever actually considering who these people are as people, who these young men are, what actually matters to them and where they came from and how they got there. You know, they love to talk about, like, well, like you talk about, like, they love to say, like, oh yeah, college sports is a way, it's helped so many people, it gives so many scholarships and it helps people get out of difficult circumstances. They love to talk about that, but individually they don't want to think about all the what that might mean for what that player decides or how that player might see the world or what that player might think about their spot in the sport after the fact, right? Because that's the other thing is, like, college, they have the players have so little power that of course they're not going to speak out. And even after they get out of college, they're still sort of like in that mindset, right? Where they're like still feel beholden. They want to be invited back to stuff. They want to have their coaches seal of approval if they want to go into something else. You know, their playing career might have ended, but they just sort of have to be on the inside of the circle. And it's a powerful thing that nobody wants to break out of. But that's all a power imbalance, right? And I guess, you know, I guess the reason that Kirk Herbstreit and Desmond Howard don't want to really delve into that is because they're part of the power imbalance. Mm-hmm. But it would be nice if we could just respect these players enough to actually talk to them and find out why they are doing what they're doing and then report that on television and add more nuance to the conversation.
Oh, definitely. Chris, thank you for your time today, brother. We'll do this again real soon, brother. It was fun, my guy. We'll do this again real soon. Trust me, I really enjoyed our chat today, man.
Sounds good. Thanks for having me. Really appreciate it, man.
You're welcome, brother. That's Chris Korman on the Bossman Show. People, check him out at For the Win.